Item C under the order of business is to adopt the adoption of the agenda. Can I have a motion for the adoption?
I'd like to motion to adopt the agenda.
A second.
This motion by trustee Perez, seconded by trustee Monroe to adopt the agenda. Roll call, I'm sorry, questions, discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera.
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez.
Yes.
Trustee Hill.
Yes.
Trustee Winfield.
Yes.
Trustee Morris.
Yes.
Trustee Monroe.
Yes.
Trustee Perez.
Yes.
Chairman Gomez.
Yes. Next item is the minutes of regular board meeting, January 23rd, 2019. The board has not had an opportunity to review this, so I'm going to ask that we put this on the next meeting's agenda, please, for confirmation of the minutes. The next item is the personnel report. Is there a motion?
Mr. President, I make a motion.
Trustee Rodriguez.
I make a motion to adopt the personnel report.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second by trustee Rivera. Questions?
Yes, I have a no. At all.
Roll call.
Trustee Rivera.
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez.
Yes.
Trustee Hill.
Yes.
Trustee Winfield.
Yes.
Trustee Morris.
Yes.
Trustee Monroe.
Yes.
Trustee Perez.
Yes.
Chairman Gomez.
Yes. Next item E, communications and announcements and recognitions. Number one is the Plato Learning Recognition. Dr. Larson, would you like to speak on that?
Good evening, members of the board. I want to thank you for the opportunity tonight to share with you a very exciting event that we have at the high school. We are being honored with an award through Plato Education for the work that we've been doing with integrating technology into the curriculum. And this is something that the high school administrators and the teachers and the students have worked very hard at since last year with using the Plato learning products for our students to be earning credits in courses that may not be offered at the course at the high school, some advanced courses as well as some of our credit earning courses. So we have with us this evening some representatives from Plato Learning, and we wanted to take the opportunity to have them explain a little bit about the award and then present that to the board this evening. So we have with us Mr. Matt Farrell and Mr. Matt Griffin, and it looks like I need to keep talking, Mr. McKenzie, okay? as he is hooking up our, speaking of technology, they have a PowerPoint that they would like to present just to show the results for how the high school has been utilizing the Plato product. And not because he's setting that up, but I can explain a little bit about Plato. It's P-L-A-T-O learning. And we use that, right now we're using it in our ECA courses. It gives individualized prescriptive learning for our students as they prepare, so we can assess students, we can see where their specific deficiencies are, and the teachers can give them an individualized prescription for their learning. And so that is happening right now in the high school. The teachers at Block are also able to use that product to help our students with their specific areas of need. We also have several students at the high school who are working in advanced courses. We were at the high school today and we had a student working in probabilities and statistics in a Plato product for our students. So our students are able to, especially those who want to get an academic honors diploma, and there are only so many slots in the day that they can take courses, so this is an opportunity for them to take an additional course. We have our partnership with communities and schools, and so our students can stay till 6 o'clock in the evening and continue to work on their online courses. So again, A lot of opportunities, it gives the availability for our students who want to succeed in additional courses, as well as our students who may take that as a different learning opportunity. So we have students who may not have been successful in a course, so they can re-earn their credit in the Plato online learning tool as well. And Plato has just introduced elective courses as well. We have students who, their day is full of all of the core courses that they need to take, but they may want to take a foreign language or another course that they just cannot fit into their schedule. They can also take the courses that help them to get that Core 40 academic honors diploma. So all of those are supportive areas. So again, we're receiving the Rockstar Award, and I've lost Mr. McKenzie. So, there he is. Gentlemen up, and they can speak to that while you work on that, and we'll see if we can get to it or not get to it. So Matt and Matt.
Disappointed, though. I'm disappointed.
Good evening, members of the board. I appreciate your time tonight to present this award. My name is Matt Farrell. This is my colleague, Matt Griffin. And as Dr. Larson said, we're here to present the Rockstar Award from Inventum Plato Learning. We work with over 30,000 schools across the U.S. who use our solutions in a variety of different ways to support their programs. Each school has a very specific goal and outcome they're trying to accomplish. And the Rockstar Award recognizes outstanding schools and their inventive and effective uses of a full range of our learning solutions. With this program, we acknowledge deserving schools around the country that have made a significant difference in helping learners of all ages and needs succeed using online learning solutions. Over the past year, I've worked with Central High School, and they've shown a tremendous passion and commitment to building programs to help every student achieve. A few of their successes are, over the past year, which I was going to show on the PowerPoint, but is in your board packet as well. We've had over 11,000 days spent in Plato working on individualized learning paths. As Dr. Larson pointed out, these are looking at areas where students may have weaknesses or also being used for enrichment, too. So it's prescriptive to their individual needs. We've had over 1,094 students in Central High School use this solution as well. So we're really reaching a broad range of your students for all ability levels and needs. So on behalf of Inventum, we would like to present the Inventum Rockstar Award to the School City of East Chicago Board, Administration, Central High School Administration, staff, and most importantly, the students of the School City of East Chicago. In addition to the award tonight, we are also pleased to award Central High School with a $150 donation, an Amazon gift card that they can use to support whatever student activities they need. I've presented that donation to the treasurer. Also, we will be meeting with Mr. McCollum tomorrow at the high school to present a banner to him to hang in his school as well, along with some mouse pads and other pens and pencils for your students as well to recognize them and their achievement. So, on behalf of Inventum, we'd like to present you the Rockstar Award to the School City of East Chicago Board. Thank you.
Thank you.
Fantastic. Excuse me, I'm in. Yes, I'd like to commend you on Plato, because I'm working through workforce development in previous years, which is Plato.
Yes.
And it was very accentual to our students, and our students, not only to our students, but those young youth who work in our program. So I commend you on that.
Thank you.
Plato's pretty good.
And I was wondering also about scholarships. You guys offer scholarships, right?
We do not offer scholarships.
No, you don't now?
Not at this point, no.
I think you guys should consider that as much as you guys make. That's just an opinion.
Yeah, thank you. I'll take that feedback for sure.
Is it possible that once we get this corrected, we can send to the board members the presentation?
Absolutely.
And also put that on our website as well? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
A couple announcements, Mr. Gomez? Yes. Each year, the Lake Shore Chamber of Commerce recognizes in their annual recognition banquet that was held this past Saturday, many outstanding business and economic development leaders in both Hammond and East Chicago. They also recognize many civil service employees and organizations, police, fire department, and one of their key elements is to recognize outstanding teachers from both school districts. Their effort to recognize teachers has been going on for a number of years. This year, Christine Jezikowski, lifetime educator at East Chicago and at East Chicago Central High School, was selected as the School City of East Chicago representative. Chris, could you just maybe come forward and stand here and be embarrassed for a minute, okay? We had a more formal award to be presented. That will be presented at a later time, but let me just talk about Chris for a minute. She's been a 20-year-plus veteran as an English teacher and department head at Central High School. She has served on a variety of school improvement committees, professional learning communities, any kind of content area over the past 15, almost 16 years. She was an integral part and contributor to the design and the development of the Central High School transformational model implemented at Central in 2010 and 11 to address the academic and probationary concerns at the high school. She served as a member of the initial early college initiative and has been instrumental in implementing the post-secondary opportunities for our students at both IU Northwest and Purdue Calumet, and now Calumet College. Later this spring, she will be completing her administrator's license, which will expand her knowledge and understanding of the school district. In May of this year, later this spring, the Educational Foundation of East Chicago hosts annually a recognition banquet honoring all of the outstanding educators who are giving many contributions in the classroom in all schools in East Chicago, public and private. Mrs. Jezikowski will be representing the high school as the high school's recognition in that. You'll be getting more information in that ceremony at a point in time. We will also bring you back at a more formal time to present you the Board of School Trustees Award for this designation with the Chamber, and also continue to support your application for the Indiana State Teacher of the Year Award conducted by the Indiana Department of Education later this spring. So with that, we'd like to recognize Chris's efforts and achievement and her continued contribution, and thank her for everything she's done and will continue to do for the students and families of our community. Chris, you want to say a few words?
I just want to say thank you to the board and to Superintendent Harding for recognizing my years of efforts and love and dedication to the students of East Chicago. I've done it with passion and belief, and I admire the pride and the hope that we have that we can become an A-plus school.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for recognizing
her. Her husband is also here. You please stand in the back. Oh, come on, stand up. There you go. Supported by a loving family and great husband that we had a chance to meet on Saturday. Really enjoyed that evening.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the recognition.
Congratulations.
Congratulations.
Congratulations. The United States History, or United States Hispanic Leadership Institute is conducting a conference this weekend in Chicago. This institute brings together leaders across the country to discuss governmental, economic, educational issues. As part of the opportunity to be so close to Chicago, the school district has had the opportunity to enjoy the discussion with Dr. Chandra Gill and Mr. Jimmy Cabrera, two individuals who will be speaking at that conference, and they will be addressing students at Central High School. You have a schedule in front of you tomorrow, primarily focused on the freshman class, and at middle school will be both 7th and 8th grade. Mr. Cabrera will be there. So we look forward to those presentations. If you have the opportunity, I would encourage you to sit in either one of those discussions, or perhaps both if you can. That's all I have, Mr. Gomez. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hardy. Moving to business number one, recommendation for approval of professional development request by Dr. Larson. Is there a motion?
I motion to accept the professional development request.
Motion by Trustee Perez. Second by Trustee Monroe. Discussion?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
After looking through some of these professional development days, we have a lot of teachers that's going to be attending those meetings. Have we secured substitute teachers for those days? Can anybody answer that?
Yes, Trustee Hill. What we do is we tentatively have substitutes aligned for the days, and then once the report comes to the board at the board meeting, we inform them that they are secured for those days. So we plan ahead so that we have people lined up to cover those courses.
Because the reason I mention that, because there's always rumor that we don't have a lot of substitute teachers at some certain times, and I know this is going to be a big event, and a lot of teachers are going to be attending. We just want to be covered. So
Right. And we also try to utilize, when it's a professional development, like we have Common Core training through Solution Tree, through the Service Center. So when our instructional coaches attend that, there are no substitutes that are necessary. We try to be fiscally responsible with how we're doing that, but the subs are paid through Title IIA, which is our state professional development grant, so that money is specifically there for us to use to support initiatives for our teachers to have training, and that will support substitute payment.
I have a couple of concerns myself too, since we're in the discussion mode. I'm not very comfortable with a lot of substitutes coming in, not to say that they're not qualified, but we're in the I-step mode right now. And I would say that we need our teachers here more than anything. I love our teachers, there's no doubt, but the students come first in my opinion, in that sense. Not to say that we didn't take that into consideration to create the professional development, but I made that real clear earlier with our board. And I don't see the Title I director on here either. And if anyone needs to know common measures, it should be the Title I director as well. She's nowhere listed on this that I didn't see. So I'll just bring out a few points. The other concern I have too is that, I wish this mic wouldn't be so loud, because it echoes back. The other concern I have too is, is the fact that, from what I understand, I did some little research, most of these professional development pieces should have been done early. But again, sometimes time evades from us, depending on what's going on. But that's just my concern, because I think overall, I think it was 67% of the teachers who are going to this. And administrators, I have no problem with. The administrators should be there, as principals and whoever else. But that's just my concern.
have one more concern. After looking at this form here, it says, "When applying for permission to attend a conference, be sure to submit your completed form at least 15 days before the conference." However, we just received this information last week.
Okay. I'm not sure what you're referring to on the timeline, but our goal is to have, because there is paperwork that needs to be done, subs that need to be secured, but that that form has not been updated, but I think it was done prior to the policy that all of the forms and information needed to come to the board for approval. So generally, that was for them to get to administration for approval. And then there is always times when people attend things, either because the state has informed you that there's a meeting next week or there's a conference within that 15 days. So that does have to be fluid sometimes for people to attend. But that form has not been updated to address the policy of having to get those to the board. So that is not intended that the board would get those 15 days prior to someone attending a professional development. That is that they need to be requesting, and right now the timeline, Mr. Hill, is that they, if they're not into our office so that it can get onto the professional development report prior to your board packet for a board meeting, then they have to wait until the next board meeting. And that causes some issues sometimes with people who need to attend things, but that's the policy that we're under right now.
Thank you.
Well, we will add to you.
Excuse me, I'm going to ask the board, could you address the chair before you start speaking?
Oh, thank you, okay.
Mr. President, if I may address...
Trustee Rivera.
Yes, if I may address that point that Mr. Hill brought out and Ms. Larson has had discussion on. If I could recall that we have had this conversation, if you go back to some of the minutes of the previous boards, there were conversations about wanting to make sure that we wanted to be ahead of the schedule. Ms. Larson's right, there are times that, you know, the state is requiring certain things to come and it's at the last minute on the state's level, but there was recommendation made that we were going to try as hard as we possibly can to make sure that the information was going to be brought forward in a timely fashion so that we would have some accessible time to review. As to the amount of time, if I could recall that, I think it was like 2 weeks ahead of time, something of that nature. I can't recall. But if you go back to your past board minutes from the previous board, we have had this conversation numerous times. And I think there was an updated form. As to the updated form, I think we were working on it, but I think this Ms. McCormick had left at that particular point in time. Just to bring that out, we should set precedent, Mr. President, in terms of setting a time period, so that way we can have this in due time.
Any more discussion?
Yes, Mr. President.
Trustee Hill.
Yes, another concern I have is that it may be some administrators or teachers living in Chesterton, and it's a travel issue, meaning that if conference starts at 8:30, do you leave home and go directly to the conference, or do you get up in the morning, come to the school administration building, and go back to the conference? Do you get the round trip, or do you put on your travel from your home to the conference in Chesterton, or do you apply for round trip travel?
No, generally, travel is always taken from the administration building to the location. So for the conferences that are in Maryville this week, the mileage would be from the administration building to Maryville High School where the conference is held. That's always the location. So it's not, if you live in, I don't know, some, you know, Valparaiso or Crown Point, mileage is not from your home to the location. It's always calculated from the administration building. But when I get forms that request travel, what we have encouraged and and tried to coordinate is people carpooling. So you may have everyone, if there's a workshop in Valparaiso, they may all meet at one place, let's say, you know, at the Radisson in Maryville, and then all ride together to Valparaiso. So our teachers are very good at, you know, trying to coordinate that. So no, it would not be, if you live in Valparaiso and you're going to a workshop in Valparaiso, that you put in for mileage from East Chicago to Valparaiso, because you're not going to drive to East Chicago and then drive back to Valparaiso.
Okay, but you'll be putting in mileage from the administration building to the conference. Is that what you're saying?
That's our generally, whenever we pay mileage to a location, it's from the administration building to that location. But what I'm saying is that because our teachers or whoever is attending generally get together to carpool, that only if they're a significant distance from the location do they put in for carpooling. So, for instance, there's the service center that we are a member of, the Northwest Indiana Education Service Center, is now located in Chesterton. Last year they were in Highland, and so if we have staff who are attending something
Chesterton, if they live in Crown Point, they get mileage from the administration building to Chesterton. If they live in Chesterton, they don't even submit for mileage to attend that conference because, you know, it's insignificant.
That you get the mileage even if you're not starting off at the administration building?
Right, right. We do not figure, you know, MapQuest for every person who's attending every conference. It's a general payment for mileage from a central location, which is in East Chicago, to the location of the conference.
Even if you're not there at the central location? I got a problem with that because I work with a company and the mileage, you know, we don't do ours like that. You have to physically be at that location to go to another location. I can't leave my house and say I'm going to Rensselaer and put down that I'm leaving the Gary office going to Rensselaer, because that's not truthful. So we're going to have to revisit that policy.
Excuse me, Trustee Hill, we could address this offline. Okay. Is there any other questions?
Mr. President?
Trustee Rivera?
No. Rodriguez.
I'm sorry, Trustee Rodriguez.
Under professional development, at the ISBA, Indiana School Board Association, if I can be added on to that on January or February 15th. I know they have me on the U.S. Hispanic Leadership Institute, but I'm only going on Saturday to that, so I'd like to go to that one as well, so if that can be added on there, that's all.
Mr. President, that is, I believe, what he plans on attending is Indiana School Board Association Collective Bargaining Seminar.
Correct.
Yeah, it's in Indianapolis.
Okay.
So anyway, I plan on attending that as well.
Trustee Rodriguez will add you on for professional development, February 15th, ISBA. Any other discussion? There has been a concern about the travel policy, and this board is going to be reviewing it in the next couple of weeks, and we'll probably move quickly on revising the travel policy.
Mr. President, I got a question.
Trustee Morris.
Dr. Larson, you just talked about the update of forms. Mm-hmm. Updating forms?
Yes.
Could we make sure that, you know, all the forms get updated, please?
Yes. It will be helpful if you're updating the travel policy, then we can update the forms to correlate to that. I think that was one of the reasons that it was not final and completed when it was looked at before.
Okay.
So thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
If there's no more discussion, roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera?
No.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
No.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Trustee Morris?
No.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Motion pa- or I'm sorry, recommendations passed 5-3. Business 2, recommendation for approval of donation. Is there a motion?
I'd like to motion to accept the donation.
Motion by Trustee Perez, seconded by Trustee Winfield. Discussion?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
Yeah, Mr. President. Do we have anyone who can answer this question? Maybe the, is she here?
I believe Laura Hubinger is here.
Laura. Yeah, the question I have is with the cell phone usage. I would like, we'd like the list of...
Trustee Hill, excuse me, this is for the donation request from Class Health Center.
Oh, I'm sorry. I thought we were number 3. My fault.
That's fine. Any discussion on item 2? Roll call, please.
Trustee Revere?
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
Yes.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Trustee Morris?
Yes.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Next item is recommendation for approval of E-rate contract renewal cellular services. Trustee Hill, would you like to make a motion?
Yes, I'd like to make a motion.
Motion is?
We talked about number 3, right?
Yes, right, or you need a motion to bring this to the floor.
Yes, I want to bring this to motion to bring this to the floor.
Motion by Trustee Hill. Is there a second?
Second.
Second by Trustee Rivera. Questions?
Have a discussion, Mr. President.
Yes, Trustee Hill.
Sorry we're making you work so hard.
Thank you.
Yeah, just a couple quick questions. After going through the cell phones, and we noted that, I noticed that you said it was 60% of people using our cell phones. I'd like to know a list of names of those individuals who are actually using the cell phones. And first of all, why do we need them?
My office can provide that to you.
Pardon me?
My office can provide that to you, the list of those who have cell phones. As administrators within the building, we do require our principals to have those in the event of emergency, for safety reasons, for power outages. So they definitely have those. And your central office administration, your technology, and your techs that need help for sure have those. So, but we can provide you those names.
I know I looked at one of them, and the payment was $255, so he's making $255 a call within the schools. So I would like to list of those who are using the phone and possibly their phone usage as well with their names on it. Mr. President, can I add to
Trustee Rivera
conversation?
Yes, go ahead, please.
Board Trustee Terrence, I appreciate that. I truly do. But can we do that for the whole entire list so that we can find out the average of what everyone's using in a particular year or something of that nature? Because then it'll give you a greater feel for how much people are spending on their phones.
Oh, absolutely.
For about a year. Are we okay with that?
Yes.
What do you, Mr. President?
Okay. Yeah, I'm fine with that. Is there any other add-ons to this?
Mr. President?
Trustee Rodriguez.
Does this also include voice over IPs as well, or is this strictly cell phones?
This is our cell phone renewal. We have other proposals coming through in here for our other services on the other two. So,
These contracts, all three, are fall under our state qualified purchasing agreement, so the best price is available for these services. We have used these in the past, so this is a renewal request. They do qualify for E-rate reimbursement. You know that AdTech is our servicing company that does apply for our different priorities early on, and these services were listed under there that our intention was to have these types of services. So we will have these phone charges, but we do get reimbursed under E-rate.
Are 100% of these cell phones being used?
Are 100% of the cell phones being used? I believe so.
Okay. Just want to make sure.
Right. We're pretty much tied to them on a lot of occasions.
Ms. Huebinger, you have the questions in mind that the trustees have asked of you?
Yes, I have that listed to provide that to you.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other discussion? Roll call.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
Yes.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Trustee Morris?
Yes.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Next item for recommendation of approval, E-rate contract renewal, CS&S email services. Is there a motion?
A motion to approve.
I second.
Second.
Motion by Trustee Winfield, second by Trustee Hill. Discussion?
Yes, Mr. President, I'd like to discuss.
Trustee Rivera.
The only thing I wanted to bring out, and I'm accustomed to the E-rate since I was part of the past board, and this is a good process in place that we have. The only thing is, if you turn to page, what's that, from the contract, page 2, and I think it's a boilerplate, but I just wanted to make sure that we were all on the same page and that we understood this. Number 2, under 8, it says that funding denial agreement termination. It says customer acknowledges that there is no right to terminate the services or services components made the basis of this attachment if E-rate funding is delayed or denied. Customers should refer to the E-rate rules and regulations. Meaning more or less, if I read this correctly, which is part of the boilerplate, is that if we're denied it, we pay it. Just wanted to make that real clear so then that way no one walks off the board and says, well, I didn't know that. Just wanted to make sure that we all know. It's a boilerplate. Have you seen this before? And we usually get the money. Okay? So I wanted to identify.
Thank you, Trustee Rivera. Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
Yes.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Trustee Morris?
Yes.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Number 5, recommendation for approval of E-rate renewal, AT&T Integrated Services Digital Network Primary Rate Interface. Is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes, thank you.
Accept it.
Motion by Trustee Rivera, second by Trustee Morris to approve this recommendation. Discussion?
Yes, I'd like to discuss.
Trustee Rivera?
What are all the actual components for this digital network and primary rate interface? I was hoping someone to be able to answer some of those technical questions regarding the network.
Can you speak up a little bit?
If we could have Ms. Jensen come up and talk to a little bit about what this is and what's it offering.
question.
Good evening, Chairman Gomez, members of the board. The proposal you have before you is renewal of our ISDN PRI circuits. Excuse me, I'm cold. The ISDN PRI circuits service all of your telephone systems in your buildings. Trustee Rodriguez, when you mentioned VoIP, these are your voice over IP circuits. These service your CS1000 that lives at the high school. They also service your CS1000E that's in the closet right over there. That services a multitude of buildings. They also cover your BCMs, your business control modules. Those are the phone systems that you currently have at this point at McKinley, Carrigosh,
Transportation.
Technology Center. So these circuits actually service all of those phone systems at this time. So those are VoIP circuits, Voice over Internet Protocol, Voice over IP. We get these circuits reimbursed at 90% from the federal government through our E-rate program, and they are under the AT&T QPA with the state of Indiana.
Okay. The other thing I wanted to know was concerning our connectivity with the... Let me bring it up a little higher. Concerning our connectivity with our systems, are we up to par with everything that we need currently?
We currently have a full gigs interface to the network for all of your data. Your voice over IP actually rides on what's called a VPN, or a virtual private network that your ISDN circuits connect to through AT&T. So those circuits do not ride on your gigabyte circuit, which is transports all of your data. Between all of your buildings, you have what are called central standard measured Ethernet circuits. They are also reimbursed at 90%. They are also from AT&T, and they are also 1 gig, and they are also under the state QPA.
And this also has the same stipulation as to what I discussed earlier about the clause indicating
yes,
that
sir.
Okay.
These are actually priority one circuits, and priority one circuits are always funded.
Okay.
And we do receive, as I said, 90% reimbursement.
Ms. Jensen?
Yes, sir.
Mr. President, I have a question.
Trustee Rodriguez, go ahead.
Yes, sir.
With regards to McKinley School, I know there was a situation with their computers, and I know they... It's been a while. It's been about, I want to say, a couple months that they've... I don't know if there's anybody here from McKinley.
I have the coach here from McKinley in the back. She's saying no.
Okay. Well, anyways, and the reason why I say this is because... wondering if you can give me or later possibly give us the copy of a work order.
Certainly, we have a full internal work order system which we work off of. Anytime there is a problem in a classroom or anywhere in a building, the individual who's responsible for that, who happens to be from McKinley sitting right over there,
okay.
She enters all of those work orders, and actually I review them on a weekly basis at the end of the week, and we determine what is still open. In general, we try to close work orders within a week. We currently have had 2 resignations in our department, and we're working as quickly as possible.
Okay. What type of application software is housing our enterprise application? What type of software is housing our enterprise application?
At this point, we currently run a full Windows network. We're running Windows Server 2008 on all of your domain controllers, as well as your DHCP servers. Excuse me, I meant servers. All of your internal networking equipment is Cisco, with some Nortel switches as well.
So let me ask a question. A lot of times when it comes to the technical side of the house, you're always looking at trying to make sure that you are 5 years ahead of time. And you're trying to make sure that as you're appropriating your actions to what your needs are we to that full capacity yet? Because you just mentioned 2008, there was a couple of years ago we were talking about that now 2 years have gone by.
We're going to be moving into Server 2012. We currently have some limitations with some of our other internal issues that I believe the board is working on. We obviously want to move all of our desktop platforms to 2007, as well as to Windows 2008. And of course, our Mac operating system is Mac OS 10.6.
Any other discussion? You know, thank you, Ms. Jensen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
want to remind the board to please address the chair before you speak. Roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
Yes.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Trustee Morris?
Yes.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Next item, recommendation for approval of educational services agreement, renewal for actuarial study. Is there a motion?
I'd like to make a motion.
Trustee Rivera?
I second that.
Motion to approve this? Trustee Rivera, is the motion to approve this?
Yes, it's a motion to approve this.
There's a motion to approve this by Trustee Rivera, seconded by Trustee Perez. Discussion?
Yes, I'd like to discuss this a little bit more.
Trustee Rivera?
And that's a conversation Laura and I have had in previous meetings. This is part of our one of the companies that we were working with, Brahman, I can't recall, it was another group that we're talking about. This part right here is a part that allows us to study any kind of things that we may utilize in terms of the financial side of the house to plan things down the road. And I've asked to make sure that when we get the results from them, that we, as board members, receive it, because I would like to read some of those areas, because these studies are very interesting studies. They're very in-depth studies.
President Gomez, Member Rivera, the JWF is the workers' comp agreement that you previously approved, so that has been established with some data, so you can get that data. The actuarian study is through Educational Services, who was part of the buyout study in 2006 that was required by the state of Indiana, that we had to make sure that we funded our unfunded liability. So you are required to have a signed agreement on file every 2 years, and our actuarians have to participate with us on our groups 2 and 3 retirees. How that simply works is that we contribute into a fund. If the group 2 or 3 retiree does not fulfill the time frame obligation, that is then redistributed amongst the remaining members. So that study is done by the actuarian and sent to Valak, who is our retiree host of our funds for their VEBA and for 401As. So because it's in a brokerage of investing, we have to have an actuarian to pull those dollars, let us know, so that way we can send it on to Valak. The redistribution occurs and we inform our groups 2 and 3. We also have group 4, where we contribute 1% into the 401A and the VEBA, which is our health insurance plan for retirement. When that group 4 does not fulfill the time frame obligated, then that money is pulled back and the district does get a credit on their next billing. That's what the actuarian study does, to study those funds that are distributed amongst those investing formats within the 2006 required retirement plan.
Right. And what I'm, Mr. President, what I'm inquiring about is the fact that I know when I did my research, there's a lot of different components that they utilize this study, especially when you're planning your financial side of the house, because there's a lot of things that they discovered depending on cohorts and things of that nature, because they have different sets of variables, those that they know of and those that they don't know of. So they create these scenarios in a simulated model fashion, you know, all computerized and things of that nature. And when I looked at this, I said this would be a good piece of information for us to be able to look at these different groups and what's going on. So then that way, in the long run, on the financial side of the house, we can see what the recommendations may be. Do you see where I'm going with that? And that will give us a set idea of, oh, okay, well, this sounds pretty good. This doesn't sound pretty good. This is what we're doing with our finances. That's what I gathered from the studies that I did.
Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
Yes.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Trustee Morris?
Yes.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Next item is recommendation for approval of outstanding checks 2 or more years old. Is there a motion to approve this?
Absolutely, I'd like to make the motion.
Trustee Rivera, seconded by Trustee Morris. Trustee Rivera, seconded by Trustee Morris. Discussion?
I need to ask a couple of questions, but I mean, they're good questions.
Ms. Huebinger?
Laura, if I understood this correctly, these are the outstanding checks that people have not claimed back or have not gotten in touch with us to claim them?
That is correct.
Okay.
On your standard check, if you notice that checks are only good for 90 days. However, we're obligated for the check up to 7 years. But according to the Indiana Code, I have to come before the board and require approval to cancel, void these checks, and receipt those funds back in. So we run a multitude of accounts and make plenty of attempts. Even if somebody right now came to me prior to this approval, they'd have to get a special letter for me to be able to cash the check anyway. So that's where we're at. So it is a requirement of the board to approve, and technically not even approve. All I have to do is present, but I always request the board to approve to acknowledge this step.
Right. And if I can recall, I'm asking a question.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. My question is, will this set of dollars be set back into the general fund? Or is it part of our whole entire budgetary plan with this?
Right. It's not generally part of our budgetary plan because we consider them as expenses. What happens is if it's issued out of a fund that is still active within the district, it is required to be receipted back into that fund. If that fund has closed, we are required to receipt it back into the general fund as non-revenue, just because it's not, you can't plan for this type of increase into the general fund. We're not talking about a lot of dollars all the time.
So then the state receives those dollars, or who gets
it? We receive those dollars right in the general fund if the fund does not exist from where the check was originally drawn from.
Okay.
So, for example, if I had some type of federal fund or state fund that was supported 2 years ago and that fund ended, those dollars will then be receipted into general fund. We are obligated to do it into the general fund.
Okay.
President Gomez?
Trustee Winfield?
How many times do you actually contact the person and let them know that their check is?
It just depends on the subjects, you know, like our payrolls we reconcile monthly. But, you know, after 90 days, you know, if they come in, a lot of times they're coming in and saying, look, I forgot to cash this check, or didn't I get paid? So we're constantly available to them. I don't send out a lot of mailings on it because it's not cost effective, but if they do find that they felt like they had a check, I am obligated still for 7 years from the time it was issued.
Looking at some of the checks that actually should have been issued, I can't see why they would just leave them sitting if they were notified that they did have.
If you look at a couple of them there that are very large, mm-hmm. What we stand to reason to believe is that they received a replacement check and they failed to inform us to void this check here. So, because we are working with a couple of third parties on our medical mm-hmm. and our workers' comp, so.
Any other discussion? Roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
Yes.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Thank you, Laura.
Trustee Morris?
Yes.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Next item, recommendation for approval, AdTech fixed asset proposal. Is there a motion to approve this?
Yes, I motion to approve this.
Thank you. Trustee Perez, motion to approve. Is there a second?
I second.
Seconded by Trustee Hill. Discussion?
Yes, discussion.
Mr. Trustee President. Rivera.
Okay. From what I understand, I think we've had this conversation before. We indicated on the prior board that we were hoping to start training people to be able to do this internally so that we wouldn't have to have an asset inventory or tagging. And I don't know where that has transpired, if it's transpired at all.
Ms. Huebinger.
President Gomez, Trustee Rivera, with the AdTech fixed asset tagging, there is a policy in place that we are required to tag assets that are worth $5,000 or more. Currently, how that operates is we have an internal person who monitors those purchases that then is turned over to AdTech for auditing, for them to review adds and deletes within our area of the school district. AdTech committed to, if you remember, Trustee Rivera, that the district was behind. AdTech did get them through 2011. 2011 and 12, that school year. We are going to be audited through June 13. Okay, so this contract takes us through that final year. We have to let this year occur so they can come in and go through and check to make sure that what the reporting that we have collected through the district for adds and deletions on our fixed assets matches actually the physical portion of this team to come out and actually do that and tag those new items. So it will be compliant for our audit that will be occurring through June 30th of 2013.
So, but the question still remains, can we train people to do this? That's
sure.
The key. And the reason I ask that, Laura, is because myself and Board Trustee Terrence are very familiar with the inventory assets because we had to do that every year. If you recall, Terrence, and we both were helping each other out to make sure that we were tagging everything. And it's not a very hard process because you have a list of all these materials that the state, as you've been entering all this through your RDS system, It lists it all because you got a state tag and a federal tag, and then you got some people who want to do a local tag or whatever kind of tags. And eventually, that's what you're doing. You're processing that. So I'm just inquiring whether or not we are eventually going to get off of $21,900 and do it internally so that we can save some money. It's just a question.
Thank you, Trustee Rivera. Ms. Hubinger, I'm sorry, are there any other questions? Ms. Hubinger, are these metal tags that we're talking about? What is this tagging system?
They're tags that you remove them, you can't hardly remove them. They're not metal, no.
Okay.
No, there's securely stuck on. I don't know if you've seen. They're very similar to the ones that are on our MacBooks where they can't be removed.
I see. Yeah. So they're simply labels?
Basically, yes, okay. But they're very difficult to remove. So.
One more question, if I may, Mr.
Sure, Trustee Rivera.
It's a very simple question. On our inventory assets, I think there's only so much amount of dollars that we're required to be able to tag. There was other dollars that, like if it's $200, they're not really all interested in that. They're just interested in a higher level dollar. What is our level?
Our threshold is $5,000 or
more.
It's per item, not as a group.
Okay, per item. Mm-hmm. Thank you, Laura. Appreciate that.
You are welcome.
I do have one more question. The assets, once they're tagged, who tracks them if they move from building to building?
That is part of our office, and the procedure we're trying to get a better handle on handling that movement between the buildings. So we are beginning inventory amongst our buildings, all inventory, not to be tagged, just a listing, so we can see where we're at compared to our over $5,000 threshold, to make sure that if they understand if these products move regardless of their worth from one building to another, that at least we can do a process from the beginning to end on reporting to us. In my office, we log the $5,000 or more purchases, and thus far we shouldn't have any deletions because we haven't had a loss or an auction or anything to that nature. So
we do have something in place.
Oh, absolutely, yes. It's handled in my office where when those purchase orders come through and those purchases are fulfilled, that is logged into our system. And it is our responsibility to provide that to AdTech so when they do go out, they can make sure that if the purchase request was to be made and delivered to a particular building, that it is in fact there.
Right, what I'm referencing is the question that President Gomez was talking about in the building transfer of things, because that's where you can lose something, and I can see where you're going with that, President Gomez, because if we lose something,
then that means our inventory can be off. That's just food for thought, and I could see where President Gomez is going with that.
AdTech does follow up that, with that during this process, because they make sure, they check to see the current tags, to see if any deletions occur at a building, they make sure it's not sitting in another building, and we have to justify those deletions.
So then, if I hear you correct, then AdTech will sit there and say, okay, well, wait a minute, from last year, this tag was here, but now where's that inventory at?
Correct.
And I think if I'm hearing President Gomez, if it's over there, then how does AdTech know it's over there unless somebody records that somewhere?
Right. They will see it, and we have to make sure that our records will match that. So our facilities does very well in trying to tell us when that happens, but in some cases, if it doesn't, see, then we have AdTech coming and saying, we have asset tag number one at this building last year, now it's sitting at building number two, and you did not record that, so you need to make that correction, and we find out why it's now sitting at number two, so.
Okay.
Mr. President? Trustee Rodriguez?
Just have one question. How long have we been working with that?
With AdTech?
Yes.
AdTech has been providing services to many school districts in the state of Indiana. They've worked with East Chicago for many years as our E-rate service provider, where they do write or plans for our priority one. You hear Mary talking about priority one, priority two, and reimbursement. So they have been with us for quite some time. For the asset tagging process, we used them last year to get us through the June 30th, 2012, and then at the end of 13 audit year, which would be June, we asked for them to prepare one more to get us through to this audit, to make sure that what we present to them, the required state forms, are available.
One small little question, Mr. President.
Trustee Rivera.
Okay. I noticed that the data system is based on an Excel spreadsheet. I'm assuming that we share that with the other staff members, like the principals and things of that nature, the transportation, whatever it is that we have inventory. Is that what we do?
That's resident in my office, because the State Board of Accounts requirement is for my office to provide that fixed asset report. RDS reporting can be handled from my office to give to the principals. So non-modifiable areas is what I would do. So.
Trustee Rodriguez.
Mr. President. Just one more question.
Mm-hmm.
With regards to what this company done for us last year.
Right.
And they're doing another audit this year. Is there any, as far as price goes, because it seems like 2012 is just around the corner, and now we're doing a second inventory audit.
Right.
Is there any?
This price is way lower than what we paid to catch us up, because we had, the district did not participate in a major asset tagging and counting system. It was a major undertaking. The number of staff it would take to do that, to get that caught up, they were 5 years behind. So we are required to have this done every 2 years. So we had to, at the time, get them caught up through 12, and then we had to live through 12, 13, and that's what this contract represents, is that 1 year.
Was there a proper bidding process took place, since this is sort of a new contract for this year?
Right. There is not a bid requirement on this. We have looked at other companies for this.
Okay.
Maximus we used many years ago. When we looked at the services that they were providing, they were not comparable to what we were expecting from a tagging system to provide us the state required forms.
Okay. Call 6320 talks about the purchasing process and what you can and cannot do in terms of your level of expenditures, or you can get a contract or not a contract. It's 6320, guys.
Correct.
Any other questions? Roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera.
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez.
Yes.
Trustee Hill.
Yes.
Trustee Winfield.
Yes.
Trustee Morris.
Yes.
Trustee Monroe.
Yes.
Trustee Perez.
Yes.
Chairman Gomez.
Yes. Next item, a recommendation for approval, request for facilities. Is there a motion on this?
motion to approve.
Second.
There's a motion to approve by Trustee Hill, seconded by Trustee Morris. Discussion? Is there any discussion on this?
No.
Ms. Hubinger, I have a question. I'm a little confused by the language in this agreement. Can you clarify the entire agreement for me?
The Jehovah's Witness has been renting our facility for over 20 years. Mr. Scott has met. He did come into my office last week. He's respectfully requesting the board to waive the standard $700 rental fee, but understands that they would be responsible for the $400 to $450 potential custodian fee that we did email him as an estimate based on how many hours that they would be in based on the number of attendees.
President Gomez?
Yes, Trustee Winfield.
Is this open to all churches?
Yes.
President Gomez?
Trustee Rivera?
May I ask a question?
Yes, go ahead, please.
You said something about $400?
Yes. Mr. Scott, who runs this program, stopped in our office and understands that they are responsible for custodians.
Right.
So he did say the different attendance rates that he's had over the 20 years, he's had as little as 70 up to 200 people. Right. So with the number of hours that we estimated that would take with at least two custodians, at least to give him a baseline on what he would do with custodians, they do offer to make sure they help to make sure that the facility is clean, but they understand the obligation of our staff that has to be there to open and close the building.
So do we have that in writing about that 400?
I provided him an email to give him an estimate.
Okay.
But what the request is from the board is to consider waiving the $700 basic rental fee.
Right, no, I understand that, but I want to make sure that he understands in writing.
Yes, that was provided by my office in writing.
Could you make sure we have a copy of it too? Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Is there any other discussion? Essentially, they are going to pay for the janitors for setup, but
yes.
We're not charging them for electricity.
That's what the standard $700 covers.
And what about insurance?
They are required to provide us the insurance certificate before we even come to the board.
Mr. Chairman, why are they requesting, and you might have answered this, but why are they requesting to waive the $700 this time?
They have previously as well, apparently. I believe it's just a matter of, you know, it's their free meeting, you know, they're not making any funds off of this per se, so they just respectfully request that the board consider that.
Ms. Hubinger, I guess I've got a little problem with this. Do they not have a location big enough to accommodate 70 people?
You know, I'm not sure. I didn't ask if they did not have a location, only because we've allowed their participation in our auditorium for over 20 years.
Mr. President? Trustee Rodriguez.
Have we done this before?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yes.
Any other questions or discussion from the board?
Mr. President.
Trustee Winfield.
So this is just for meeting purposes, if a church is having something and...
Right, they're having a lecture.
Okay.
Okay. And the program consists of a lecture to which the public is invited. There are no tickets sold, nor is any admission charged.
So as long as a church is having something where they're not charging, you waive that fee, is that what you're saying? Just for a meeting?
Well, I come to the board, if they request that I bring to the board a request to waive the fee, mm-hmm. and then I do that, I bring that to the board, at least that you're aware of it.
Mr. President?
Trustee Perez?
I would like to move to have further discussion about this in a committee or a work session.
There's a motion to move this into a work session discussion. Is there a second? I'll second it. Discussion? Trustee Perez, any discussion? Okay, roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera?
Can I ask a question, please, real quick?
Sure.
I'm trying to understand the motion.
There's a motion by Trustee Perez to move this into a work session so we could discuss it for the consideration.
Okay, I got it. No.
Trustee Rodriguez?
Yes.
Trustee Hill?
No.
Trustee Winfield?
No.
Trustee Morris?
No.
Trustee Monroe?
No.
Trustee Perez?
Yes.
Chairman Gomez?
Yes. Motion failed. There is now a motion on the floor for recommendation approval request of facilities by the Chicago Congregation of Jehovah's Witnesses. Roll call.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez?
No.
Trustee Hill?
Yes.
Trustee Winfield?
Yes.
Trustee Morris?
Yes.
Trustee Monroe?
Yes.
Trustee Perez?
No.
Chairman Gomez?
No. Next item is recommendation for approval of self-insurance fund resolution. Is there a motion?
Mr. President, can we go back to that motion? I didn't hear you say pass.
We did that motion pass.
That's our motion pass, the one with...
What is the count on that, 5-3?
5-3.
The motion's been approved for recommendation for the request of facilities.
Thank you so much.
Is there a motion on the floor for recommendation for approval of self-insurance fund resolution?
I'd like to make a recommendation.
Is a motion on the floor to approve
pass
this?
It. Yes.
By Trustee Rivera. Second?
Second.
Second by Trustee Morris. Discussion?
Yes, I'd like to have some conversation on it, though.
Trustee Rivera?
Yes. Mrs. Laura, I know you're well prepared for this. And that's good. Just to let you know, so am I. But it's a good thing. I think this is something that we need in terms of us looking at the insurance reserve fund in terms of transfers of dollars. The only question I have, because we have had some conversation, and I did note when we met with the old organization that there was a question that we knew that based on our cost reduction, there was $500,000 in the self-insurance piece, and now we're requesting $900,000, so there's an additional $400,000, and I loved your explanation in terms of how you were exploring the concept. The only thing I just couldn't grasp my head over was the $400,000 and how that is brought to the forefront.
If I know...
I can't hear you.
If I think I know what you're talking about, in our earlier cost reduction, in 2011, we did make our settlement with the understanding that rates would not increase in 2012. In order to cover that, there was a $600,000 transfer that we had to transfer from the insurance reserve.
Okay.
Subsequently, as meeting with the insurance committee, they knew that the potential could be that we had to go to the reserve, but the reserve must maintain a $3 million balance. We as a district are entitled to go below that $3 million, but we are required to maintain a $3 million balance. Our goal and our hope
within the Finance Committee, the previous, and will continue with the next group, is to make sure that once we do get our general fund into the state that is, meets the requirements of being above zero and maintaining a 6% to 8% cash balance that we were agreed with the teachers' union, anything over and above that, we would consider then coming back to this resolution and coming to the board with another resolution to put that money back, to keep that reserve for us to be viable for our insurance and insurability.
Okay. The other thing, too, is I noticed, based on your spreadsheets, okay, that because we're asking for that transfer over, there was two spreadsheets you had in there. One was
yes.
with the negative, and then
prior
the other
to the
one
transfer.
Was with the positive,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yes,
okay.
sir.
So now, are we intending to also take from that general fund, now that we bring in that the self-insurance over here, to go from the general fund to the Title I, because we have some scenarios there?
No.
No, okay. I wanted to make sure it was clear.
No.
Okay.
Any other questions? Roll call, please.
Trustee Rivera.
Absolutely.
Trustee Rodriguez.
Yes.
Trustee Hill.
Yes.
Trustee Winfield.
Yes.
Trustee Morris.
Yes.
Trustee Monroe.
Yes.
Trustee Perez.
Yes.
Chairman Bowman.
Yes. Under item G, other, School City of East Chicago Board of School Trustees, Indiana School Board Association legislative appointment. Superintendent Harding, would you like to discuss this?
Yes, I would. Thank you, Mr. Gomez. The Indiana School Board Association, as you know, is comprised of about 294 school districts in Indiana. They operate a very similar structure in terms of identifying their officers and also having committees work that represent cross sections of school boards from around the state. Their primary work with committees is policies and bylaws, something that would be important to all school districts in Indiana. But they also have a legislative committee that affords membership to each school board in the state of Indiana to have a member represent their board on that committee. And it's a large group. And from that group, they develop their legislative agenda and potential resolutions and the priorities they have for the Indiana legislature. So with the board reorganization, I know you've established categories for committees, but this is one where you have the opportunity to provide a person from this board to the Indiana School Board Association legislative group, and I would encourage you and recommend that you do so.
Thank you. Given your explanation, I would like to appoint Trustee Rodriguez to that position, if you will accept.
I accept.
Thank you. I'd also like to, on the subject of committees, announce the committee's chairs. For the nine committees that have been established for the school year, or I'm sorry, for this year, 2013. Head of Finance will be Frank Rivera. Trustee Rivera.
Yes, I accept.
Safety and Security, Trustee Hill.
I accept.
Arts and Music, Trustee Winfield.
I accept.
Trustee Rodriguez, Bylaws and Policy.
I accept.
Trustee Morris, Transportation. Trustee Monroe, Buildings, Grounds, and Maintenance. Trustee Perez, Curriculum and Instruction. Next item is public forum. Before we start the public forum, I'd like to ask Attorney Lesniak to say a few words on public forum.
I think that's on. Thank you, Mr. President. It's been a long time since I've been able to speak, so I can appreciate the time. This section of the meeting is the public forum, and that's the opportunity of those members of the general public who have signed up can address the board with your comments and your concerns. The rules are that you have 3 minutes to do so, that we ask that you make no personal attacks on any individuals. Just because it is not a question and answer time, and because the board doesn't immediately respond to you, that does not mean that the board has not heard your concerns or heard your questions. People are taking notes. Your concerns and your questions will be referred to the proper administrators, and you will be contacted about those concerns and questions. Thank you.
Thank you, and I forgot to mention, Trustee Ramos will be heading the Technology Committee. I'll turn over this portion of the agenda to Trustee Winfield and Trustee Hill.
We ask that when you come to the podium, you state your name and address. Irma Lardyville.
Excuse me, I'd like to inform you all, I will be keeping the time for you.
Good evening. My name is Irma Lauderdale. I live at 1542 Chase Street. I'm a resident of Gary, Indiana, formerly a resident of East Chicago, Indiana. I was born and educated here. I attended East Chicago Roosevelt. 37 years ago, under the National Coalition of Title I, Chapter I Parents, they formulated with the U.S. Department of Education in Washington, D.C., a group that would go throughout the nation and train parents as to how to advocate for their children pertaining to the Title I program. 6 years ago, we had the honor and the pleasure of bringing that program to Northwest Indiana. For 31 years, that program had been held in Indianapolis, Indiana. For 15 years, I sat on that board, and I thought Northwest Indiana deserved a chance to show what we had did here. There was no way that I was going to bring a conference to Northwest Indiana and involve Maryville, Hammond, Gary without including East Chicago. So it was an honor to have East Chicago on board. That conference is coming back again to Northwest Indiana, and again we're asking that East Chicago parents be allowed to attend. Those parents will be trained. You will select the parents that will go. Those parents will come back and train the trainers. They will train other parents. Because we know it's always costly when you attend a conference, it was indeed a pleasure to have our parents be trained in Maryville, Indiana. And the reason why it was in Maryville, Indiana, because it was the best facility that we could have, that we could house parents that would come from the other six states, as well as put on workshops. Therefore, I am passing this package on to your superintendent. I have a book in which last, in 2006 when we did it, the superintendent, I think, was Dr. Anaya, and East Chicago played a very vital part. We showed the best of the best schools in East Chicago. We also had some of our bilingual components shown to show the nation what we were doing as far as our education was concerned. We also showed the museum in Cary Gosh Schools. So we showed some of the best of the best schools in East Chicago. We'd like to do that again. So I have passed that information on to your Title I director, and I'm going to work real closely with her. I just wanted to make the board aware of it also. Thank you, and I thank you for letting me speak.
Thank you. Thank you.
John Zerlingo, president of AF 511, AFT.
Good evening, Mr. President, members of the board. My name is John Zerlingo, president of the East Chicago Federation of Teachers, Local AFT 511. We appreciate the strong and diligent work that this board is doing to bring excellence in education to the school city of East Chicago. We want you to know that the East Chicago Federation of Teachers concluded a vote on December 6, 2012, of no confidence in our administrative leadership. Over 99% of the vote was no confidence by the teachers. In a separate ballot of non-certified staff, who voted, 100% voted no confidence. This vote was conducted in an atmosphere of low morale and a sense of fear and intimidation experienced by many teachers. One of our members shared 24 points about why teachers have no confidence in administrative leadership at the last board meeting. This evening, I will emphasize two. The School City of East Chicago has been on suspension from receiving grants from the foundations of East Chicago because $118,733.76 of unused grant funds that were supposed to be returned but were not. These grants stemmed from 2005 to 2007, totaling $454,602. Our administrative leadership only needed to return these funds of $118,000, which were unspent, unused, required to get the School City of East Chicago off suspension. Administrative leadership was requested in November 2009 by the foundations to return the funds so the suspension would be immediately removed. Instead, in December of 2009, $90,174 was transferred from the foundation grant funds to a new fund eventually allegedly used for the strategic plan purposes, ignoring the foundation's request to have these funds returned according to its policies. So $118,000 plus went unreturned until this last June 2012, after the State Board of Accounts required the School City of East Chicago to follow the law regarding safeguarding grants. How sad and terrible for the East Chicago, for the children of the School City of East Chicago, who lost out on potentially hundreds of thousands, if not millions of dollars in grants over the past 4 years under our administrative leadership's watch. Why have steps not been taken all this time, even since June 2012, after the money was returned? Why haven't steps been taken to reestablish the relationship with the foundation? This is unconscionable. At what cost to the children of East Chicago can we continue this type of leadership? We plead, AFT 511 pleads with the board to reestablish this fractured relationship with the foundations of East Chicago. Secondly, why have we not heard anything from our administrative leadership regarding the Baldrige survey? L&R consultants have established a relationship with the community and teachers, and it was our understanding that they were to play a key role in making these results available to the community and to the School City of East Chicago. Was our administrative leadership forthright in this information? It's been in its possession since January 2nd. We ask for your assistance in addressing these problems and the serious problems of our administrative leadership. Thank you very much on behalf of AFT 511.
Thank you. Lali Rosala.
Good evening, board members. My name is Lali Rosala. I'm a school counselor at Black Junior High. The topic of discussion lately has been the bilingual program. When I began here in 2004, we had the bilingual program, which is different from the ESL program. The ESL program services those students learning English. Bilingual program provides instruction in students in a student's native language, and all students may be included in this program. The bilingual program enhanced their reading, writing, and speaking skills in their native language. As a guidance counselor in the junior high level, we used to have a feeder system from the elementary level. Students in junior high were placed in bilingual speech. We no longer have this class. From there, the students would enter high school and be placed in Spanish 1S, which stood for Spanish for Spanish speakers. This was not just a regular Spanish class, where you learn numbers, colors, months of the year. Spanish 1S was a class where the students learned to give presentations in Spanish, read deep literature, write reports on worldly topics. This was the bilingual program back then. Many students who went through this program have gone off to college and are now using their strong second language abilities, which we all know being bilingual is an asset in our world of work. We are just asking that administration and the board members entertain bringing back the bilingual program. We are willing to do a work session for the board to show statistics and true benefits the bilingual program provided for our students. Thank you.
Moses Paz.
Again, we ask that you announce your name, your address, please.
My name is Moses Paez. I live in Whiting, 1539 John Street. I'm a pastor here in East Chicago, been here since the early 80s, since 82, at Harbor Assembly of God. And I have been informed that the bilingual program had been dismissed. And of course, I inquired, speaking to some people to find out what was going on. And it seems like it was, it's been put to the side for the simple reasons. I don't know what the reason is, but I guess because of it wasn't profitable to some people. But the Hispanic bilingual program is, was a program that was beneficial to the Hispanic people. And I just wanted to come out to find out and see what's going on with it, because some of our youth, which speak primarily Spanish and learn English while they're here, if they're told, let's say in school, not to speak Spanish, they have to speak English, it becomes a difficult problem. Instead of having a bilingual program where they're able to learn the English language and still be able to speak their native language. And I just wanted to find out what's going on and what was the reason why it was eliminated or discontinued. And so I ask the board if they can give information as to what happened and why it's discontinued.
Thank you, Rep. We'll get back to you.
Thank you.
Tony Beretta.
Good evening, Mr. President, members of the board, Dr. Harding. Primero, quiero decirles a ustedes felicitaciones por el éxito que tuvieron en la histórica elección. I did this for a purpose. I saw a couple of you blink because you did not fully understand or understood what I said. I wanted you to feel the impact that our young children are going through when they are not able to fully understand the English language. We are not asking you to address a particular ethnic group. We are asking you to address a particular need in our community. And digressing a little bit, an observation that I want you to pay attention to. A few years back, we had 12 administrators, Hispanics, in the school system. I want you to know, if you don't know already, we have none right now. And the gentleman from the union stated it's unconscionable, it's doubly unconscionable that we allow that. I represent the Unión Benéfica Mexicana and the Coalition for Immigrants. I represent 23 different organizations, local, state, and national. I also volunteered my time in working with Ms. Van Winkle at Westside on the strategic plan. Those were words that we put, and we must follow those words and make action out of them. We all say that history repeats itself. It only repeats itself if we don't learn from it. In the 60s, during the civil rights movement, why did the people rise up? Because African Americans were denied the opportunity of a level playing field and having good education. And that is what we're asking for. Help us, help our children have a level playing field. We're not here as adversaries. We're here to support you in doing your job. I commend you for taking that opportunity or taking that challenge to do what you've done. So there, let me just say with this, I know we need an ENL specialist, and I will ask you to consider that. And also,
Mr. Beretta,
to instill the bilingual program.
Can you please not disrespect the board?
Thank you.
Rick Morrison.
Again, we ask that you please respect the board in the 3 minutes, please, allotted for your time to speak. Thank you.
Good evening, gentlemen.
Good evening.
Congratulations on your election.
Thank you.
I'm a lifetime resident of East Chicago. I represent a lot of veterans, Emilio A. de la Garza. I was the founder of that organization, a lot of Latin veterans there. And I feel offended that we do not have that English second language for our children. So I'm here in support of the programs, and I hope you consider it. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Esperanza Ramirez.
School board, congratulations. My name is Esperanza Ceja Ramirez, and I'm an East Chicago resident, 4240 Olcott. I am also a concerned parent. I have two children who underwent, first of all, the first restructuring, and through my time being here, there have been three restructurings. Enough is enough. I have a second daughter who is about to go through the entire restructuring again. At the rate this is going, I refuse to have her to go through this. Another problem I'm having is the school voucher. I myself am not employed. How are the taxes going to come out to pay that voucher? That is not going to be possible. I meet the state requirements, but the following year, guess who's going to have to pay for that? Me. I'm not working. But I'll tell you what, I will do everything in my power to make sure that my daughter goes to a very good education. She is entitled to go to have the good education that every one of you underwent. Just like I put this responsibility on the professionals, the teachers, they had every opportunity to have an education. I expect that from those teachers. I also like to consider some options. Have more tutors, have more bilingual teachers, social workers, because at the school my daughter currently attends is highly predominantly Hispanic. I'd also like to consider that the school board take a closer look at outside districts. For example, Whiting. We are not allowed to send any students, or they're not allowed to admit any students, only 6th or 9th grade. Another example is Munster. If I try to send my child over there, she'll be considered an outside district resident, and I'll have to pay out of pocket $2,300. That is not provided by the school voucher. So what does a person like me have to do? Nothing. What can I do? Find somewhere where my child will definitely be able to get a good education. And I'll tell you this, just like I speak English, también puedo hablar en español y yo sé qué ha andado pasando aquí en las escuelas públicas. Yo también sé la ley. In other words, I do know the law. Public law 221 says that every school anywhere in the state of Illinois is graded A through F. I don't care what school it is, public, private, charter. Where are those signs? I don't see Franklin or Block signs. Those are F grade schools. Harrison is a B grade school. Abraham Lincoln is a B grade school. I would suggest that moving forward, all elementary schools take into account to keep those schools or those students who are entering fifth and sixth grade, keep those students in the elementary schools. Stop busing our children to Franklin. Those are F-grade schools. And I will not tolerate that. And trust me, I will take this further. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you. Juan Andrade.
Juan Andrade, 4005 Elm Street here in East Chicago, Indiana. Pretty much I want to talk about three events. First of all, it has to do with something I mentioned at the very first meeting. Marianne Buckle, she's the principal for Douglas MacArthur Elementary School in Cedar Lake, Indiana. She was a recent guest of Nuestra Comunidad, Northwest Indiana, with Eve Gomez and myself. The reason I invited her on our radio program was that I read the article in the newspaper that her school was a school that was actually 46% of the school had a with poverty level. It's a Title I school, and it was also on probation. That school wound up winning the National Blue Ribbon Award. I invited her on a program. So I have the link for that program that my co-host Steve Gomez sent to me. I would like to request that the school city put this on the link on the website so that the people, as well as the school administrators, teachers, and everyone else, be able to hear her story, and that everyone here and whoever listens to that program will be able to learn and maybe take some of the things that she did at her school could work possibly in some of our schools here. And that's on WLTH 1370 AM, and we're also on Ustream.tv, so I do have the link. Also, I want to talk about real quickly is that coming up on Saturday, February the 23rd at 9 a.m., there's going to be a youth rally, of which the featured speaker is going to be Dr. Bernice A. King. She is the daughter of Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. So this rally is a youth rally. It is free to the public, and it's going to be taking place at the Van Buren Baptist Church, 2585 Van Buren Street in Gary, Indiana. It is free. The main thing is to just get there, and I think we're asking is that people carpool. That is free. At 1 o'clock, also on that same day, there's going to be a symposium for up to 250 kids. They have to pre-register. There's going to be workshops and a free lunch. So they have to pre-register ahead of time through the website. That's www.keepingthedreamalive.org. And that's for the first 250 kids that pre-register for that event. And then finally, on April the 12th and the 13th, at the Hilton Hotel in Crystal City outside of Washington, D.C., there is going to be a national conference on improving low-performing schools. Let me say this once again. On April the 12th and the 13th, at the Hilton Hotel in Crystal City just outside Washington, D.C., there is going to be a national conference on improving low-performing schools. I've seen this on the website for the national National Association of School Administrators and the National Education Association. So I would suggest that this would be a good opportunity for some of the personnel from the Chicago school system to attend this national conference. Thank you.
Thank you. Byron Duke Florence.
Good evening, Mr. President, board members, superintendent. Real quickly, Westside Junior High is still closed. Do we have a plan of action for that school? Because if not, you can rest assured Ball State is going to be looking at that place to take it over as a charter school. Field School, I'm under the understanding that the school city has sold that school to the city for a dollar, and I'm sure the board is looking into that to see if it was legal and so forth. But if not, if the school city has sold this property to the city of East Chicago, when do they take over this school? And if so, who's paying the salary and the maintenance for the employees and the personnel at that school currently? One thing I want to mention too, I think everybody here has been hearing all this medical conclusion on concussions for high school athletes. And you got to remember this now. These kids here in East Chicago started a Pop Warner program at age 7. They go into a junior high school program at 10 and 11. They go through a high school program, you know, for 3-4 years. And trust me, these kids at some point are subject to the same damages as these professional athletes. And trust me, I know what I'm talking about. You know, I'm a product of this city. I played Pop Warner. I played high school. It was pretty good, All-State. Played at Northern Illinois University, honorable mention All-American. Had the opportunity to play with the Kansas City Chiefs, Chicago Fire. You know, and I question myself sometimes about how much damage did I endure without even knowing it. So do we have a program in place for these high school athletes? Who's monitored? What doctors are on the program? And what procedures are we doing to prevent that? I think that's something that needs to be looked into, because you got to remember this. 90% of all high school athletes ever go to college and play any football, baseball, basketball, or whatever. And that's something that needs to look into. And another thing, the Indiana Bylaw 20-2, that's something that needs to be seriously looked at, because now if a child is alleged to have been recruited by another entity, they can lose all their high school eligibility by one complaint. So when you get into a situation where jealousy occurs from one guy going to another school and they wanted him at this school, and somebody files a complaint with the state, you make a child ineligible and they had nothing to do with it. That needs to be looked into also. I want to comment Ms. Hermogene Lauderdale by saying congratulations on getting these parents involved, because you look around, I don't see not one parent here representing their child. And that's something we need to look into. And I am totally in support of what Mr. Beretta said, because I am truly a victim that benefited from the civil rights movement. Thank you.
Thank you. Ray Flores.
Hello, my name is Ray Flores. I'm a school teacher at Block Junior High School.
Your address, please.
My address is 8541 Madison Avenue in Munster, Indiana. Good evening, East Chicago School Board. Good evening, Mr. President. The bilingual education had been a cornerstone in East Chicago since the early 1960s, so much that it was a showcase for universities and other school districts in the state. Let us not confuse bilingual education with the English Language Learner, ELL, program that assists non-English speaking students to acquire the basic English language skills necessary to function in our schools and society. The bilingual program, on the other hand, had challenged our students to become fully proficient in two languages. School City of East Chicago data clearly showed that the bilingual students were one of the highest academically performing groups in our district. A significant number of Central High School valedictorians and salutatorians, as well as up to top 10 and honor students, have been the product of the bilingual program. Students who had been successfully participating in East Chicago's bilingual program were able to take the foreign language placement exam and test out of up to 3 years of college level foreign language and qualify for 15 to 18 college credits, depending on their score, even before they started their college education. Our children were able to receive bilingual instruction, which built on their native language while introducing them to English. They eventually became too proficient in both languages that we developed special bilingual classes at the elementary level, at the junior high level, and the high school levels. Universities that offered bilingual endorsements placed their students in our schools to learn from our program. Districts who were experiencing an influx of non-English speaking students would inquire as to how East Chicago was so successful and achieved such high marks with our bilingual education student population. Research clearly shows that bilingual students tend to have greater cognitive abilities than their monolingual English speaking counterparts. Several studies suggest that when it comes to executive functions, those thinking skills that require problem-solving, mental flexibility, attention control, and task switching, bilingual students have an advantage. East Chicago has been and continues to be an enclave, a magnet for immigrants. We continue to receive students who range from kindergarten to 12th grade who are versed in their native language. The bilingual program became a reality, not just because our students needed the service here in East Chicago, but because our community demanded it. Now the school city of East Chicago has chosen to offer these children only the most basic language acquisition program that will be giving them barely the fundamentals of the English language. Instead of raising the bar, challenging them, and developing the skills to give them a cognitive advantage, what was the reasoning behind doing away with the bilingual program? What community stakeholders were involved in the decision-making process to dismantle the bilingual program? The last bilingual program director retired and was not given the opportunity to delegate their responsibilities. I want to thank you for your time, and hopefully we can straighten this out, because we have success stories all over the world that are products from East Chicago and the bilingual program.
Thank you. Reggie Tisdale.
Good evening, President Gomez, Vice President Hill, and members of the Board of Trustees. My name is Reggie Tisdale. I reside at 4801 Walsh Avenue. I'm a teacher at Carrigash Elementary School, and I've been the Teachers Union Working Conditions Chairman since 1999. From 1999 to 2005, I worked on teachers' issues with Mr. Richard Lesniak. At this time, I'd like to welcome him back formally to the School City of East Chicago. Mr. Lesniak, I'll be real honest with you. During that period of time, I didn't think a lot about you, but the previous past 7 years, I've thought a lot about you. And why?
Because we try to refrain from saying the names, though we understand. Just say attorney. We don't want to say no names.
Oh,
you want to shout out?
And the reason being, Mr. Lesniak dealt with me professionally, respectfully, dealt with the teachers fairly, and did everything in a timely manner, and I thank you for that, and welcome back. Second of all, I'd like to congratulate the girls' basketball program for their success the last 2 years. Last year, under the guidance of Eric Cundage, Vanessa Hernandez, Keith Walker, and the rest of the staff, the girls finished second in the regional finals. That's the furthest our girls' team from East Chicago Central High School has ever went in the history of East Chicago Central High School. Not, of course, Washington and Roosevelt, but East Chicago Central High School. I commend them for that. They also had an outstanding year this year, finishing 12-11 with a bunch of inexperienced young girls that are going to be just that much better. And I say this because I love basketball. I travel Indiana, all four corners of the state, and I see good basketball. And there's not being any basketball coach better or better organized with people to put their time and their lives into it than the staff at East Chicago Central Girls Basketball. And I want to commend them for that. And finally, obviously we read things daily about budget crunches, finances, general funds, how the Republicans are strapping us, and Mitch Daniels keeping money from children. You're going to be involved in a lot of serious budget work this next year, I would guess before June. As I read in the paper, it looks like the Munster School Board's already started on doing some things. But as you do so, I just want to refer you to a book called Indiana School Finance. It's authored by the leading expert on Indiana School Finance in Indiana, Dr. Thomas Dykel. He's been treasurer at Hammond Schools at Lake Central. He's the leading expert. So at this time, I'd like for you to, you know, you could all purchase a copy for $19 through Amazon.com. If it's not appropriate to give you this, my copy to you, Mr. Gomez, you can, I'll just loan it to you, okay? All right, thank you for your time.
You're welcome.
Thank you. Linda Randolph.
Good evening, Linda Randolph, 4437 Alder Street. First of all, I'd like to extend congratulations to your Teacher of the Year. Rashad and I sit on the Lake Shore Chamber of Commerce Education Committee, and we know the quality of education is important to the businessmen in the area, and so we want to salute your Teacher of the Year. On behalf of the East Chicago Education Foundation, we do have information out regarding the many grant applications, so we want to encourage teachers to apply. The deadline is March 8th, and we'd also like to ask you to put it on your website so that they would all have access to this. I would also like to receive confirmation of the date for the Teacher of Excellence Celebration Dinner. May 23rd was requested. This committee is chaired by Mr. Trevino, so we'd like to get confirmation for May 23rd. And I'd also like to encourage us to make sure we stay on top of what's happening in the area. On Saturday, I attended a three-hour meeting at Michigan City High School. There were legislators there, some key legislators that are pushing the vouchers, full-day kindergarten, charter school expansion. There was State Senator Arnold, Charbonnet, Soliday, all those people that we could have asked questions of. In the audience, we had Valpo, Portage, Michigan City, Hammond, no East Chicago, no Gary. So I want us to stay on top of what's happening. I understand that it was sponsored by ISTA, which I believe is the State Teachers Union Association, but they came into our area, they listened to parents and all of those people who were available for about 3 to 4 hours, and I would have really liked to have seen some from our district. Thank you.
Thank you. Did Ruth pass? I know I'm saying your last name wrong.
Hi, yes. Yes, thank you. Good evening. I just wanted to let you know that I used to be a teacher's aide for the ESL program back in between 98 and 2003. And I was a teacher's aide for the TESOL program. And I tested the children as they came in. And I just want to say that it's very important that we get this bilingual back into the schools. It was a joy. Not only did I teach them, but they taught me my language back once again, and it was great. And that's all I just would like to say. Thank you.
Oh, thank you.
I'm sorry. My address is 1539 John Street. I live in Whiting. Thank you.
Thank you. Carlisle Edwards. Rashada Moore Morris.
Rashada Moore Morris. I live at 6119 Reverend Burns Drive. I'm the other half of LNR Innovative Solutions. I want to reiterate what Linda said about the Teacher of the Year. We're very proud of her. We are members of the Chamber and we sit on the Education Committee, and education is economic development. The one thing I want to bring to your attention, in addition to the items Linda mentioned, we have tried through Rotary International. I am the president for Hammond, which is a business association, to involve Central High School in our World Affairs Conference. It is a conference in which we bring all of the students from Lake County together. At this time, we have 12 schools from Lake County. We have included East Chicago. Our problem the last 2 years is East Chicago hasn't shown up, and we've paid the registration fees. And we support East Chicago, and we want to see you there. This is an opportunity for the children at the high school to interact with kids all across Lake County. And these are some of the top kids. The topic for discussion this year will be, is peace possible? In addition, there will be three nationally known figures that will speak to our children during the conference. There will also be a panel of local people consisting of chancellors and industrial people who will talk about peace on a local level, state level, and globally. This is a world conference. It provides a big view for our children, which they need, and we just want to have your support so that the kids at East Chicago Central will show up this time. Linda is the chairperson of the committee. She has already been in contact with the principal, and they have had conversations, but we just thought we'd bring it to the board. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Emily Panchari.
Good
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen of the board. My name is Emily Pancheri. I am a teacher at Franklin Academy. I spoke to you guys 2 weeks ago regarding my treatment by the school city of East Chicago. They still have not lived up to my mediation agreement. The social studies position that was never properly posted, given not just once but twice to an unlicensed teacher and to a teacher from the outside, is now still apparently gone. This is ridiculous. This is in violation of my agreement. When this man, Michael Harding, fired me illegally 2 years ago.
Excuse me, can you refrain from saying names, please? Thank you.
I'm sorry. When someone fired me illegally 2 years ago, I fought. I was given a job, not my properly licensed job. I am a licensed history teacher. But this is ridiculous. I want to know why I'm being treated like this. Because apparently nobody seems to be able to give me a reason. No one. When I started October 10th, I was the fifth teacher that those students had had from August until October. You average that out, that is a brand new teacher every six school days. That's not fair to them. That's not fair to anyone. You approved a social studies teacher. I have sent numerous emails to human resources, including one on Friday. No one seems to be able to get back to me. My sick days are not accounted for. My proper pay is not accounted for. This is all in violation of the agreement. And I am not going to lose my job over continued mistakes and mismanagement. Because I am not an elementary teacher. I am a very good history teacher. And apparently we are not learning from our mistakes in the past. And we will repeat them. But I am not going to be silenced. Not by anyone. And I want this board to do something about this. I thank the board for their time.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mario Quiroga.
Good evening. My name is Mario Quiroga. I live at 2211 Lithuanica Street in Prairie Park, East Chicago. And I have a complaint of a teacher, so-called teacher. This teacher has been very disrespectful to students, calling them names, insinuating comments on their weight. We do not need a teacher like this in our school system. This teacher works in Central High School. And I will not mention names like I was told. But this teacher needs to be reprimanded or dismissed before we have students getting out of hand and having a massacre. We do not need that in this area. All parents need to know this teacher should be removed from teaching.
Sorry, Mr. Quiroga.
Yes, sir.
Right here in front of you. I'm sorry. Could you discuss this with the board offline, please? This is more of a personnel matter, so we'd like you to discuss that with the board afterwards.
Well, I just wanted to make sure you are aware, and also this teacher is under an investigation. I went to the school today, and they told me they will be investigating.
Okay, we'll talk
allegations.
About it. We'll talk about it offline. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you for your time.
Yep.
Paula Castaneda.
Good evening, members of the school board and community. My name is Paola Castaneda. I am a junior at East Central High School. I'm here today to share with you my experience as a bilingual student. As a child, I learned Spanish. Spanish was my first language and was a dominant language at home, so going into an environment as a child where English was dominant could have been very hard for a child 5 years old. So I was fortunate enough to be able to enter a bilingual program in kindergarten and continue it throughout elementary. And as I got to junior high and high school, I was able to take those programs as well, and as they offered, as teachers had said earlier, they were for Spanish-speaking students, so I didn't have to learn the ABCs again and everything that I already knew, thanks to being my first language. So I was fortunate enough to take those courses where I was able to learn how to properly use Spanish language, and write it and learn it with my culture as well. So I didn't just do it. I was able to continue to learn about it throughout high school, and I feel like it should continue. I don't understand why it was discontinued beginning in kindergarten as it was when I was in school. And I also want to say that thanks to learning Spanish, I was able to learn the English language properly. I was able to learn to spell, use grammar, and it helped me be able to speak in public areas, and gave me confidence that I wouldn't have had. And it's proven that Spanish does help with cognitive skills. It doesn't even have to do with language, but just the fact that you know the language and you're able to properly use it shows that, studies show that it has helped students, and it is the second most spoken language in the United States. So I feel like offering it to students at an early age and continuing the bilingual program and having it as an option for students is proper for students to help them in the long run and be able to help them get into their career when they're older or continue to have confidence and to be able to, like, I don't know how to say it, be able to succeed in life, And like I said, I emphasize that the bilingual program should continue and should not be discontinued, because it did help me, and it will help my success when I'm older. Thank you.
Thank you, Paula.
That was the last speaker for the evening. Date and time of next meeting will be February 28th at 6 p.m. Central High School. Is there a motion for adjournment?
I make a motion to adjourn.
Trustee Hill, seconded by Trustee Morris. Roll call.
Trustee Rivera.
Yes.
Trustee Rodriguez.
Yes.
Trustee Hill.
Yes.
Trustee Winfield.
Yes.
Trustee Morris.
Yes.
Trustee Monroe.
Yeah.
Trustee Perez.
Yes.
Chairman Gomez.
Yes.